advertising channel 33, video graphographer for tonight's meeting is Rob. And you can check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. You can see yourself on TV.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Thank you. The first item on the agenda is a request for determination of applicability, 2017-05, 178 Haverhill Street, map 29, lot 89, DeMarco. And the applicant, DeMarco, has withdrawn the application. So Chuck, can we go to old new business?
We sure can.
Determination of applicability for 2017-4, 23 Tennyson Road, map 33, lot 165, Tortia. And I believe we have something, we approved that last meeting.
We did.
I prepared a determination of applicability and Norman has reviewed it, so you can look over it quickly, but it's quite simple. It was for just the porch on the front of the house.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That is the RDA before, isn't it?
No.
Oh, no.
You didn't go to Tennyson.
Is there anything special?
No.
Nothing special, as a matter of fact.
This was the one that Jack Sullivan flagged the wetland. And maybe if our discussion, it would have been outside of the 100-foot, yeah. That was the one we were talking about.
Chuck, do you have a blank piece of paper?
No, please.
Sure. Bob, can you put that in the back?
Well, I have it right here, so I'm just running a little late. I had to provide, do a certificate of compliance at the last minute. So, which got done. So the sign-in sheet, I'm just gonna pass that around here. Put that on the table when you're finished.
There's another DOA, 2017-2, roadway maintenance project.
Yeah, we signed that at the last meeting, and I noticed that there was an error.
I don't want to call you Bill.
On the file number, so I did want to send it to DEP in that way. So I'm just asking the commission to re-sign the order.
Anything on Artis Senior Living?
Yeah, we tried to set up a site visit this morning, but engineering couldn't make it. And I also couldn't make it at the time they suggested. So we're trying to set up another one for next week.
Do you know what time, when?
The invitation hasn't even been generated yet, so I'm not sure. We're trying to get a lot of people together, so it would be Lynch, it would be Delbrook, the engineering department, Hayes, myself. And I will inform the commission if anyone wants to go to that. Commission is looking for just verification that the planting survived, an additional granted bounds where the abutting property is. There was a high point in the wetland connection that was made. There were two ponds, and part of this project was connect those two ponds. I did go past and saw some wetland vegetation growing in that high point. So there is a little bit of connectivity there. So we wanted to have that graded down so water could flow easily from the pond by Main Street into the bigger pond and then out into the wetland. So those were some of the things that were asked for. And then engineering's there because somehow, well, they're just going to investigate, but there's a blockage of a culvert across the street, which is causing some flooding, and they want to make sure that it wasn't part of a culvert getting damaged when that site was being developed. So, and engineering is definitely the more important player in this this site visit.
We have a continued notice of intent, 270-0681, 14 Strawberry Hill Lane, map 7, lot 193, Moynihan. I believe we did receive a new plan. I guess Jack won't be here tonight.
Jack could not make it.
I see that there are a lot more plants in the area that we had talked about the last meeting, which I think is a great idea. And you kept, actually think, I like the fact that you also kept the yews along the outside, you know, as a border. I don't have any more issues. Did everybody have a chance to take a look at this? There you go.
Line with what we discussed the last meeting. I thought this amount was added in this corner and then some as well in the corner of the yard there. I think from what I can see, they've made the most out of what they can out of the yard.
Right. Still giving them the opportunity to have, you know, the pool and the apron in the back.
Yeah.
Dave, did you have a chance to talk?
I looked at and compared the both of them, and I think it's an improvement. I think it's good.
Yeah, I looked at it. It's an improvement over what was done last time. Did the engineers give an estimate as to what sort of square footage coverage this now generates?
I don't have that exact number.
In your conversations with
I know even before the plan before that we were close to, you know, we were over 2,000, so I would imagine this has to be in the wheelhouse because this certainly is more.
Okay.
So the plan before was over 2,000, so this has
to. Proposed to us last time.
Yes.
Yeah, last time was 2,700 square feet. It was just spread out, and we tried to consolidate it more towards that vernal pool area.
Okay, so it's 2,700 square feet when all the trees hit, you know, a 30-year maturity kind of point, right?
Correct.
Yep.
Chuck, do you have any questions, comments?
Yeah, just to the commission. So we have two orders of condition, one that's existing and one for this pool. And the one that that's existing that the house was kind of finished on and continued that work. I just want to make sure that the commission is satisfied with that 2,700 square feet, so it doesn't come up when they try to close that order of conditions. So I want to make sure that everyone feels that we have fulfilled that planting area. If you understand what I mean by
yeah.
that.
Yes, I do.
The two plans are in a sense conflicting, or the two orders are in a sense conflicting with each
mm-hmm.
other. Just want to make sure we've settled that out before that next that existing order comes in, and then we say, "Oh, wait a second."
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
The other thing I also have to take into consideration is with all the new plantings that are here. Once these things get some traction and grow, you're gonna have a much more vibrant tree density and understory here than ever was on that lot previously. So, what is gonna be what's gonna grow as after these get planted is much better than it was ever there. So I think, you know, you look at, you know, from a practical point of view, that this is much better than what was there previously.
Are there any comments from the community?
I make a motion to close. Chuck, we don't have anything prepared for tonight, correct?
I don't have this prepared. I did let Jack know that a couple days ago that it wouldn't be
we
ready.
Were aware of that.
Yes, we were aware of that. Yeah, we were hoping that you would be able to vote tonight,
right.
And then when Chuck had the opportunity to catch up and write.
Yeah, so the typical process here is that we'll close the meeting, and that's usually Chuck's go ahead to start writing up the order of conditions, and
okay.
Hopefully next meeting comes and we'll go through the order of conditions, make sure everything's in line with everything we discussed, and we'll vote on the order of conditions at that point. So
I see.
We can still so a motion still stand, make a motion to close.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Do you have any other business to discuss, Chuck?
Yep.
5 minutes.
We have minutes?
No, we have no minutes. You guys can start reading the order of condition. That could certainly happen.
I
finding?
We actually have open.
We're not talking about it, right, okay.
Being a little after 7:20, we have a continued notice of intent, 270-0680-1260 to 1264 Main Street, map 45, lot 104 and 106, Mass Equity Investments, LLC. And I believe we got a copy of the order conditions, but we also have language, the conveyance of the easement that we had asked for in the last meeting. Hopefully, you've all had a chance to look at that. Okay.
All right, so, yeah. Do you want, I just put this up because it was something we talked about today. This site has some trees that need to come down. There's a lot more site on that plan than there is in the buffer zone. And I asked John to tell me how many trees on each lot need to come down for their initial development. We were trying to figure out a way to move this forward and have us satisfied with what Mass Equity is going to bring to this application and then what others may in the future also bring and have a benchmark to start from. So this plan shows the trees that are going to stay and the trees that are going to be removed, and it's broken down by lot, and it comes out to 24 trees will be removed. Now we have a tree policy that asks for one-to-one replacement, but we also have a variance request that in the past we have interpreted as if you can provide as a contractor an overwhelming community benefit, it's looked upon favorably to allow stuff. So, and they are putting in a trail, three parking spots, and a kiosk, and we're not doing anything to get those. So for me personally, I think that that balance is great. There is a give back to the community. It's an it's access to an area of Kirchian Woods that we didn't have before, and it'll really help out. There are some trails out there, but there'll be new trails put in. So that's if you have anything else to add, John.
No, you summarized it pretty well. Most of the tree removed. There's some in the front with the stormwater management areas here. Not much in lot four, because this is where the pool is. It's just a lot area. And trees here with the retention pond is here, and a couple by this subsurface stormwater management area. So those are just trees related to the infrastructure site work. It's not for individual lots. Now, some of these lots here have trees which will be subject to the tree policy when they come into each of those intents. Mm-hmm. So we're just asking for the site work in lieu of the trail, in lieu of the tree policy. So some of these trees will be cut down, will be part of the policy, but later on down the road. That's all I'd like to add to it.
Because I think I understand what you're saying. They'll be part of the tree policy later on down the road. That means when the houses come in, they're
right.
Gonna?
Well, for the layout that's depicted on the plan right now,
yep.
The trees that need to cut down are there.
These things you just cut.
If there's, you know, there's always an opportunity for another builder or developer to buy a lot and develop them themselves, or a pool, depending on what the market wants.
Mm-hmm.
So we are only using our variance for these trees, and that overwhelming public aspect of the job.
Just the ones that are colored on there.
For this part. Now, when someone comes in and changes the plan and has to cut down new trees, they have to abide by the tree policy.
Okay. I think that makes sense. Does that contrast a little bit of what we're saying in here about...
Yeah, did you... I saw something about trees.
Like no other trees will be cut at all after.
Well, in the that's a standard condition. On that.
That's Jamie's old.
Jamie's standard condition to not. It doesn't say you can't do it. It just says you can't do it without permission. So there is that condition in there, but it also highlights the 24 trees as part of a variance request, which this order of condition actually. Says that we accept it. So, you know, that's, I wrote it and anticipating the commission may accept, you know, what they're doing for work for the trail and the parking.
We may want to consider revisiting this language at some point. It really just says this restriction shall survive any issuance.
Is that Jamie's?
Yeah. So that, if I'm a different commission reading this in the future, I'd say, well, they said never cut those down. You should, you know, someone coming back to us may look at this and say, you can't cut it down.
The best way to do that is to, if you have like a draft of what you might think is great, start out with that, and then I could send it to the commission for some discussion. Do you have any changes that you want to do now to that?
So I guess my only, I think, in general, effect. On the plans currently, we're showing all of the ones that would potentially be taken down. Not just the orange ones there, but we're identifying the ones that a future homeowner may...
Yes, we identify every 6-inch caliper or larger tree in the entire site.
Yep.
And we showed in the buffer zone, just highlight the orange ones, ones we need...
The ones that you need.
The infrastructure and roadway and social grading. Some of these back here, we don't need to cut down for the roadway. The homeowner may come in later on and say, I want to take some of those down because I want a patio pool. And those are subject to a tree policy.
I think in either way, I think this strategy, because our language right now is for the 25 and 10 foot. It's not it's not necessarily. So I think in this case, it's probably fine.
Okay.
Could you just add a caveat that without requesting approval from the committee?
Yes. After compliance, it says this restriction shall survive issue.
Okay.
Unless the additional request is granted by approval of the committee. also the individual lots are gonna be, if they cut trees down, they're gonna be under the guidelines for individual homeowner, not a contractor.
Yeah, just the, just the lots and the buffer zone.
Right. Right, just the individual lots will be under homeowners.
But really, what's gonna happen is, the reason why we're kinda in this quagmire here is because Mass Equity doesn't know what the planting plan is. This, we don't have a planting plan. So they could qualify for, you know, the replacement policy just with native planting and any planting they're gonna do, you know, as part of their build-out. So it may be a wash.
Yeah, no, I think in the end, we may end up, getting, I think my, I'm fine with the whole planting and, you know, particularly in, with regards to what we're getting back.
To make sure it's kind of memorialized in the order, the number of trees that we anticipate are gonna.
It's it's on 11.
I think he does indicate, yeah.
Is it on 11?
Yeah.
I think it says 24 trees.
So that's where it talks about, this is what they're doing for us, and that's why we're gonna grant a variance.
Okay, yep.
There's a couple things that I just see here that I want to make sure is clear. Is that, you know, this is obviously a different condition because they're not building the houses. Yet there's houses shown on there, and I think we're all aware at this point that these are just rough layouts, and your proposed work, Chuck, certainly doesn't include that. But I guess I want to, and I can propose some language, but I want to propose, like, actually stating that in here, that this does not include the houses shown on there, or it, just so it's clear that somebody doesn't come back and say, well, this plan shows that it's this many square feet, and the commission said that's okay.
So on number six, you want to add some bullets?
Yeah, just.
Do you have some language?
I can.
You can come up with something?
Yeah, I can come up with something.
John, and I was gonna ask John, did you review that? Is that all the proposed work? I mean, I didn't want to limit him to that amount. I mean, that's kind of one of the dangers of putting something like that in
there. Yeah.
And it does, it really doesn't have to be in there at all.
Yeah, you know.
Because we can just say, you know, the proposed work is generally this, but it's in the application.
Yeah, I think so. But always, the houses are outside the buffer zone. Lots 1 and 2. They construct those without filing those with 10.
Yo, absolutely. No matter what, that's out of our jurisdiction. So,
it says here it's only lots 3, 4, and 5 are included in this.
Right.
This
here. Sure.
Yeah. No.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. I guess so. In that same line, we've all had that the same conversation of the drainage is sized for a certain square footage and the total square footage that we have, and do we need to memorialize somehow that this is what the total square footage is? You know, this is kind of what we brought up earlier of, it's great that we've got, no matter what happens, the three lots are coming back before us, so before something goes in, we'd have an opportunity to see that. But if, you know, those other two aren't, you know, we don't have a review of, is this drainage plan adequate still? And so, do we need to add some sort of language? Just that
I think that wouldn't be a bad idea, and it, you may want to. I mean, you've oversized the system, so you know what your square footage is.
Right.
Do you know what the upset limit would be?
Right.
It was my understanding that for all the impervious surfaces, for all of the homes, that your infiltration is a multiple of that for the entire development, not just lots 3, 4, and 5. Is that correct?
It's
for all.
Yeah. Everything, every house, every impervious here, we calculate. We oversize the footprint of the house to fit in there.
Yeah.
But didn't you also calculate based on the original roadway?
Yeah.
Width?
So
there's a big reduction in this project.
Oh yeah, because that's right.
Right. Down the system itself.
Yeah.
You know, to give some. We own Lyrian.
There's a lot.
To redo it,
yeah.
You know, it made more sense just to keep what we had in place there.
All right.
So
I think it's not gonna have be a problem.
We're showing over, I mean, you're showing a large size on there, I guess.
So really, they went from 40 feet or 60 feet to 20 feet?
So to width?
Well, yeah.
30 foot to 26 feet width.
Yeah, yes.
Except for the cul-de-sac.
Did engineering review the drainage calcs?
Yeah.
Cause I'm not too savvy.
Alright, and the only other question I have on, because this is a little bit different of a project, is when is, you know, I was looking at the bond and then thinking of the certificate of compliance, and I just wanna make sure we're all on the same page of when this is done, what the site looks like when this is complete, because there's gonna be no houses, there are gonna be trees that come down. What's the finished product look like?
Would the certificate of compliance for this be basically the utility, the construction of the,
so the
cul-de-sac
road,
and the utilities and the infiltration?
So the way this, so it's really only going to be lot 5-4-3. So the roadway can be finished off, and we're looking for a certificate of compliance on those lots.
But when somebody comes in and develops one of the ones within our jurisdiction, don't they have to file a notice of intent?
They do.
And so they will have their own certificate of compliance.
Right, and we have given, some towns don't, but Reading has in the past, and you would get a partial certificate for everything involved in that one lot. So you're not, you can't separate things inside that lot, but let's say lot 5 is complete, they want a certificate of compliance, so we would say all aspects under the order of condition for lot 5 has been satisfactorily completed, you know.
Okay. I have a question about lot 1. So does this certificate of compliance cover those plantings that are outside of our jurisdiction? Those replacement plantings, do I see that correctly? Those
inside
green?
Though. So
yeah.
Those are part of the planning board.
Those weren't replacement plantings for this.
Right. It was just a buffer.
So are all the trees, are all the you're not doing replacement, you're just taking the 24.
At this point, right.
That's the point.
Right.
Okay.
Those were requested by one of the abutters.
Gotcha. Right. So I was just wondering, you know, in our certificate of compliance for this order, are we looking at those trees? Do you know anything?
It's outside of jurisdiction.
No,
I understand, but you know, kind of part of the plan, you're looking at them, they're trees that are being planted.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Is that gonna be part of what we can
I wouldn't be looking at the trees. I would focus in on those three lots and in back
the
of the in houses. And if there was any erosion, it would be on that side. I mean,
right.
We certainly could, you know, if something was happening, we were getting erosion, you know, outside of that detention basin, we could look upstream into the, you know, storm drains or something like that. But the town's going to have a bond on that. That's really engineering that would make sure that that's working.
So just a quick follow-up, if I may. So the certificate of compliance for this will also include the trail establishment with the kiosk and the final for that as well.
Yeah, because if the covenant does list the Conservation Commission.
Yeah.
As
so that is actually something that is not in the order, but I meant to put it in the order. So
okay. We
have language from Arcadia Ave, and I'll just adopt that. So let's make sure that that's in there. It's just going to ask us to finalize that easement prior to the certificate of compliance, any certificate of compliance. Yeah.
Okay. Any other comments from the members of the commission?
I just had a question on the last sentence of finding
the bond
number.
No,
I think we should strike that sentence. It might be artifact. So do you mind striking the last sentence of finding
one? Oh, I saw that when you mentioned it before.
Okay.
I I did incorporate Franklin Street into this in certain spots, but, and I thought, when I first read it, I go, oh, no, that's right.
But that's fine. It's still, I mean, it's a template, I just wanna make sure the artifacts get out.
There's another spot where it says Franklin Street, is that?
There is, there's Franklin Street's identified somewhere in here, and it's supposed to be.
Okay.
When it talks about the drainage.
'Cause I thought that as well, okay, 'cause I thought that as well, and then said, oh, but it's in here later. Did we previously, well, purposely, we previously had it closed this, correct?
No, it's not closed.
Yeah.
At all.
Do we open this up to comments from the community?
You, yeah, you can take comments from anyone. I just think that, there's a couple of things that I added that no one talked about, so I just wanna
You did such a good job.
Come clean on that.
All right, come clean.
There's something in here that says, if everyone remembers, there was a certain area where the first test pits were, and we moved the flags. Well, that historically was, maintained as lawn. In this order, I've asked that some plantings go in there, and it gets to be, it gets turned back into a wetland, or at least some plants, that will work in that area, semi-dry, semi-wet area will happen, so.
Did you have a number?
Let me, I'll find it in a second.
You sure you got that in there?
I did. I'm gonna find it.
I did see it.
And then the bond, you gotta talk about the bond too, just to make sure that everyone's understands that.
What area?
I mean, I saw that you, where you had called out this area, but I don't know that I saw anything where you talked about it.
Well, I'll, you can move on, talk about the bond, I'll find it and then let everyone know.
Number three, page 12.
Oh.
I think it says 11. Yes, beginning of 11.
11.
Which is still fine, right?
And I have that in findings, that's the problem.
Yes, so you need to
So, page 13, number 11.
Need to address number 11.
You just need to put that in the conditions.
Should we put in a number of shrubs, or? Like, you know, at least three, or something like that?
At least three?
At least three?
Well, that's not
I'm just going on my memory.
We're thinking about a little bit more of the work.
No, it's still
Not much in that area.
No.
At least three becomes three.
Maybe I could write that they would just propose something and it would be installed with the site work, so you guys could come up with something for that area. Doesn't have to be much, but
Okay.
it'd be better not to see grass growing in there, 'cause it would draw people
Yeah.
down to mow it, I guess. I don't know if it was was mowed before. I would say you're looking at 25 specimens out there somehow. Shrubs and plants, yeah. It's pretty big. It's a pretty big area.
Well, I mean, I guess at that point they're not really asking for a variance, so.
I'll say 12.
That's a good compromise. Want to say 12?
Sure.
I'm fine with that. Yeah, I'm fine with that.
And let's go on to the bond.
All right, Tom.
Which is A3?
A3, last page.
What's the value we typically use for a project this size?
So 364 Lowell Street, we asked for $20,000.
Yeah.
This is something, I mean, this project is not very wetland intensive.
No, it's not.
So
relative to that one.
This is a placeholder or something to get you guys to notice it, but you're right. I mean, but if three separate builders, you know, you gotta think in three, so it's
they're gonna
10
come into
each,
us,
five each.
Three separate builders are gonna come into us. This is just for this work.
The utility work.
The setup.
Right.
No, this is the order of conditions. So when they start, everything's, you know, in play. And someone could, I mean, I don't know if someone wants a square house, but you know, you could build within that building envelope and you would never have to come back to the commission.
I thought that's exactly what I was trying to say earlier, is what I didn't want them to do.
Well, no, you're approving everything inside there can be, so outside of that would be an increase of pervious, but inside of it would be less or at least equal. Why do you, so if it, you know, all the jigs and jogs of a building, you don't, that doesn't matter to us. We've approved, they can be inside of that or they can build that square.
It usually does matter to us. We usually want to see plans of, make sure those, you know, this is a bunch of different contractors. We want to make sure that contractor comes in and they understand exactly what this commission is looking for and not just go off of an existing plan, you know, passed from one guy to the next guy to the next guy. I think that's why I was looking to have that exclusion of this does not include the houses that are shown on the plan. I think we want my understanding was no matter what, when a house is proposed at that location, they're coming back in here to talk to us.
For the 3, 4, and 5 or for all lots?
The 3, 4, and 5.
3, 4, and 5.
Just 3, 4, and 5.
Yeah.
This is all just 3, 4, and 5.
Well, I don't agree, but you guys can do what you want. I mean, we've done this a lot in Boxford, and they do a building envelope because they don't know what's going to happen. So unless they change it, I mean, I could see, let's say on number 4, I could see, is that a deck? I don't know, I'm thinking that's a patio in the back. That might be too small, or it might change. They'd come in for that, but if they could fit the rest of the house, I mean, that's more likely to move than someone saying, I can't fit what I'm doing inside that house. So, I mean, inside that box. You know, you are given permission for what you're seeing on the plan.
So, it gets back to then the aspect of, so why is, and I guess I would look to the applicant to speak to this, but why is this applicant going to hold a $30,000 bond and wait until every single one of those is actually completed? And that's kind of my point of, what does this look like? When does this get returned? And $30,000 may not be the right number.
But it's a nice math number, so we know it's 10 each.
Yeah, but so.
But I would assume, and this is not even our call how this works, because this is more business than conservation, they would pass that number on as part of the purchase price. That's just it. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what they did at 14 Strawberry Hill.
When it turns over, that's what happened.
And they sold that, the bond went with it. It was part of their agreement. So we need, before anything starts, we need a bond. If they can also do all the houses or half of them, they might choose to do the ones next to the wetland. They might have a hard time selling those three. Maybe those are the ones they'll have to develop themselves. But you know, I just don't want to cause anybody, you know, I can remember Builder coming in here, and when we made a small change, it was like, you know, he couldn't believe he had to come back for another meeting. So, again, you're approving that box, and anything that happens inside the box meets all the numbers that we've put together, including stormwater. If he doesn't cut down any trees, and then when he does his as-built, we'll know about the trees, we'll know about whether he fit inside that box or not. I mean, that's how it goes. I mean, if he's out, you know, within that width of professional judgment, it's nothing we call anyways. I mean, maybe an overhang is sticking out a foot.
Absolutely.
That's not really what it's all about. And why would you come in to spend two meetings and have a consultant talk for you for something like that? It's caught in the certificate of compliance process.
So
would you want to have them submit plans of their final design prior to, I mean, that we can approve? They don't have to come in and talk? They can, you know?
Yeah.
Would that work?
I'm not opposed to what you're saying. It's not what I thought was happening, so I'm just trying to digest it.
I thought each of the homes within our jurisdiction came in when they went to develop it.
Sounds like you've set a pretty comprehensive schedule of requirements.
I mean, we could add that they, you know, and I do, outside of this, I do have the sign-off process in the building department, where if I notice that the plan is different, and that's usually where I catch it, then I let them know that there's a problem. I mean, lot 5.
Barely in.
No. You know, I don't know. I mean, that doesn't seem to really match what's being built now.
If this is adequate, what's the point of piling on more adequacy? I guess that's my question.
Yeah.
Well,
and
that's what I
mean, these
say.
Bonds can go on for a while. You know, that I think we've seen it in the past that
we asked for two on the plantings. We've asked for survivability report for 2 years, and then it drops away as soon as they're planted. And we've said that on the bonds, we can keep up to half. So placing that bond at a good number works. Now, this is not 364 Lowell Street, where it's, you know, wetland intensive, lot of work, all that. So, you know, it might be better at 5 each, you know. I mean, I probably should start putting real numbers in there, but
We see the big numbers. We say, "Oh, that's great."
Yeah.
I think 15,000, 5.
That's 5.
One of the things that, correct me if I'm wrong, but just thinking back a couple of months ago, these boxes that you drew on this development plan, weren't these approximately 125% of what your anticipated structure was going to be?
Pretty much, probably a little bit larger, but about that.
Yeah.
We were into padding areas too.
My guess
is it's highly likely we're going to be back here for 3 notes from tents, because there's already talk about lot 5, about changing things up there, and we're going to be back for that one. So I'm pretty positive. The house is not going to be the boxes. There's going to be pools and patios involved. We've got to calculate those impervious areas and compare it to what's approved, and so. You know, maybe we get something inside that box, create it exactly like that, but I'm thinking what I'm hearing from the applicant and contractor, it's things that are like twist and change, and can we, you know, less house, more patio, type of thing, so.
So are we approving the final plan? Is that what you're saying, John?
What's that?
There's most likely they're going to change, and we're going to approve the final plan.
And I think what he's saying is in line with what we were thinking. Is like, if 5 changes dramatically, they're coming in for an NOI. That's not a minor plan change, or they're not coming over. Well, we changed the layout. Here's a minor plan change. They're coming in with a separate NOI, or no? Is that what you?
Separate. So my worry is if we think we can fit that box, we twist it around, and then later on you say no, this is a major change, and then we may not be in compliance.
Yeah.
And so, you know, that's why I would talk to the applicant. You probably want to approve a plan beforehand, because if we're not consistent with that, with this plan, you know, we're gonna be in a little bit of trouble. We'll actually forgive this later on, which, you know, may not satisfy the commission.
No, I
I think a lot of that's covered, though. I mean, that's pretty standard for us. If it's a minor change, we accept it as that.
Right.
And if it's a major, I mean, I would assume a major change would be a pool. And you might have to do a notice of intent for the pool, especially on these lots, because there's really no room for it. But I'd like to see how that one went. But everything else might be a minor change.
So a major change, and I'm sorry to just hammer this, but a major change comes into us for just lot 4. What does that do to lots 3 and 5 under this notice of intent? It's currently, and we just can't come to an agreement. What does that do to lots 4 and 5 under this order of conditions? Because there's a point when you start dealing, we're breaking it out into separate entities, and we're trying to approve 3 different plans that really are nowhere near final.
Didn't you say you have an approval process? And don't you look at, won't you be looking at some of this stuff as it comes in?
We would have to include that in here, that they have to.
I would think a pool would be, why would you want to amend the entire order when you could just do a separate notice of intent for a pool?
Mm-hmm.
These are pretty big houses. Looking at lot number 5, and I think I just said it, and then John kind of backed me up. I said, that doesn't seem to work for what I've seen being built in Reading right now. So someone might have a different idea, want to put a little bit more into it. So, but
and then they come back just like Strawberry Hill and do a notice of intent just for that change.
Well, let's say it's the first one. So if number 5 comes in first, we could amend it.
Yeah.
But let's say we've amended it once, and now number 4, 3, and 4 come in, and they have a big change also. Like, one's a pool, and the other one's pretty much out, so I don't expect anything from number 3. But you might just do a minor plan change, or the pool, if the pool's over a number 4, then that could be a separate notice of intent. I mean, we can't permit this.
Go ahead, John.
John's trying to see.
And we had this conversation back at the office. Is, I don't know what I should say, but at the same time, say lot 4 is sold off. He comes in and says, I've got order conditions for this. And he just blows a big project. And then it jeopardizes the entire order conditions for lots 3 and 5. So I'm concerned then, and then the applicant no longer owns that property, has to do something about lot 4, where they've breached, you know, outside the allowance of the previous area. So I think that talk with them and planning, looking ahead, if they're building the whole thing and said, yeah, just keep on the 1.
Yeah.
But the fact that we've broken up, I think there's some concern there. Someone goes cowboys and just kind of goes off page there, and we come back to you and say, we got a problem here because 3's not compliant, 4's not in compliance, but it's a different homeowner.
Yeah.
So that's the only concern I have.
Yeah. So Chuck, it sounds like his concern is the same as ours, and it just seems like it makes sense to say this excludes the houses. I mean, the square footage is part of the design, but any plan for the houses should be coming back into us. And, I mean, you know, I would argue for a smaller, but it makes this project much smaller as well.
We did have a change in one of those. Could we just simply request that they provide more infiltration on that one lot?
Yeah, absolutely.
But I'm a little confused why you're concerned about what happens to one lot if the other two are still in compliance. I'm a little lost there.
The infiltration basin was based on the amount of impervious surface.
Mm-hmm.
So if one goes really crazy, there may not be enough infiltration in the basin. So,
well, I guess the reason I asked the question the way I did is, what control can we exact on each lot to make sure they don't exceed that? I mean, this plan provides for that, correct?
Yeah, so it's going to be written into the order that the, all five lots have a total impervious area of this.
Right.
That can't be exceeded without some additional infiltration.
But do you break it out as an individual per lot, not just in total?
So doesn't number 14 satisfy that?
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah, and I suppose you could read 14 as it's per lot. And I, you're right, Bob, I think that's what we talked about. It is per lot, and if, you know, somebody on a single lot wanted to go larger than that, they would have to.
Those impervious numbers are on one of the plans.
Directly on the plan, right, yeah.
Broken down per lot, so you can ask for that at the time. Does it match up the number that was shown on the definitive plan set?
And can you read number 17 next, talking about changes to the house configuration?
I think that covers it there.
All right.
You Chuck, you're way ahead of us.
Just have to remember where these things are. I'm glad you can talk a lot because it gives me time to find this.
Chuck, I found another little
Franklin.
No. Found another Franklin?
Yeah. Page 17, 31A. Halfway down, just omit in the middle of that paragraph, or bioretention LID areas.
Okay.
Thing. What was the other?
So it was the bond, and it was the fact that I wanted some planting. We agreed on 12
yep.
plants, and I think we're talking about a $5,000 bond.
I'm fine with a $5,000 for per 3, 4, 5.
So
15 total,
yeah.
in essence.
Yeah. Any comments from the community? Hearing none.
Oh,
sorry. Yeah,
so
representative.
Since our last hearing, there's been a name change. It's Veterans Way. They met with the Veterans Office. So that's a change in the plan, and Planning Board asked us to make changes to the plan on the milars. And there'll be a change of date on the plan too to reflect that. Just haven't, we don't know what that's going to be yet. So according to Julie, it's the same plan. It's just the name changes, and it'll be a date that's revised different than yours.
Is that something?
I mean, I can probably get
it
to you.
See, so if we close tonight, you can get it and you guys sign. I can
just
as soon as that comes out,
said,
I can put it in as the last revise.
We've notified.
Yep, 20 days.
So we're on the same page, you know, down the road.
I didn't prove Veterans Way. I make a motion to close.
We didn't ask the.
Close NOI 270-0680.
Do we hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Then I make a motion to approve the order of conditions as amended.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Did you folks look at the covenants agreement and conveyance of easements and utilities and the covenants agreement and conveyance of easement and rights of way and future rights of way?
Yeah, we have talked about it.
I think it's okay.
We can push that off. If you want, or if anyone has any comments.
I just have one thing. It just,
sure.
That was a little confusing to me because the future roadway right-of-way and the easement for the trail were melded together there. all jumbled up in the same language. That was confusing to me. But that's I think, an issue for the town council.
So we're gonna submit this, up the ladder, and if you just wanna write a general comment, I'll submit that also. So for someone who has, the ability to read this kind of language.
It's so easy to read, what are you talking about?
They could make sure it's in there. I don't know, unless John has any comments, I mean, yeah, exactly.
When I look at it on here.
I think that's what the problem, so we had one on Kylie Drive that was a paragraph. This is a lot better.
Yeah.
And we asked for that because we had, didn't have a template.
Yep.
So this is beyond anything that the town or the Conservation Commission has done on their own. But it's because we saw the faults that we fell into over at Kylie.
Kylie Drive, sure.
So.
Yeah, when I look at it on the plan, I see it in Technicolor. When I read it, it's not so much in Technicolor to me. It's confusing.
Mm-hmm.
I know that it says what it says, but, you know, the square footage of the road easement and then the trail easement, and they're together. And it doesn't really kind of, it didn't specifically sound like one was within the other and encompassed the other.
So it's the trail is underlying is the roadway, but the roadway will eliminate the trail system if the roadway ever goes through.
Right,
so,
right.
May just move the kiosk or parking.
Out to
other
areas.
Right.
I don't know what the possibility of that is. I mean, the Kirchian Woods in that area is a chapter 97, not gonna happen. I don't think it's gonna happen. I mean, and the town likes to build. They also like their open spaces. It's valuable to them. It attracts people also. So I don't see that happening.
On the rights of way and future rights of way, under A, it says the trail and kiosk, the width and design of which shall be specified by the Town of Reading Trails Committee and Conservation Commission. Did you have an issue with that?
Oh, you're asking me?
Mm-hmm.
I just didn't want to have dueling ownership, so we were going to eliminate the Trails Committee, and it's just going to be the Conservation Commission is going to be in charge of this, and the Trails Committee wants to do anything they can do it through the Conservation Commission.
That's fine. Want to do it that way?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think that's what Al asked for, right?
Yeah. And this has already been plotted right on a plan. The survey locations of this have already been plotted.
No, the trail's been marked out, and with you, Jeff, is to figure out what we want to go. We don't want to cut down trees if the trail shows up, so we're going to maneuver our way and work with the grades to satisfy the conditions.
Oh, sort of serpentine.
Right.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's great. It's.
So we don't approve this, we just look at this and offer
if you
anything?
If you don't have any comments, I wrote down the ones that you that Dave said and you said about the other aspect. And
this
I'm
has to be
gonna,
approved by our attorney.
Well, it's going to go to Julie next. She's going to look it over, and then probably Jean and Bob, and then, there might be a sense that it's okay, or it can go to town council too. So we're just going to, someone else is going to say this is good, and we're going to go with that. But eventually it will go to town council. I think engineering would want that too because of the roadway.
Julie already got a copy too.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So before we close, I don't know where you were going next, but just remember that we need to approve the variance also separately. It can't be separately.
There's another item here that has to do with the pool.
This is an order of condition. There's a certificate of compliance request. That was what I was doing when I was a little bit late. So I have that prepared. But that's a separate order of conditions, so we don't want to kind of mix the two.
Okay.
So I close and we approve, though, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. I think the regulations say that you have to have a separate approval process for the variance. So even if it's not exactly right, let's just do it anyways and just get that out there.
Do I hear a motion?
I make a motion to approve the variance on the plantings as indicated on the plan and in the order of conditions.
And for the tree replacement.
And for the tree replacement.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay.
All right.
And now for the certificate of compliance for the pool.
Do you wanna give any background? You want me to do it?
You wanna do it?
Sure, so it's always discovered with every project, there's a hidden order of conditions that it was forgot to get a certificate of compliance. So when you get an order of conditions, typically before you can start any work, you have to record it. So that catches everything finally when a sale happens or you want to remodel or refinance. So Henry Smith wanted to put a pool, a deck, and a fence around the pool, and he got an order of conditions back in 1988, which needs to be closed out. It's the 1264 project, and when we were out there on our site visit, though we didn't specifically look at the pool, we did see it, and we know through this project that we just approved, there's a house going on the pool. So this, it seems to me that there's a lot of
basement.
Yeah. there's high groundwater where that house is. So it seems to me with what was asked for in 1988, they didn't ask for much.
So there wasn't anything about like properties or
giving the rest of the land to the commission. There wasn't anything. Well, there was, remember that one over on...
Well, exactly, that's it.
They had something like that. No, there wasn't. We're not getting a bonus piece of land or some access somewhere. This is straightforward pool, patio, and fence, and I recommend that we sign off on this old order of conditions from...
Do I hear a motion?
1988.
So
moved.
Second.
Oh, sure.
All those in favor?
Great.
Thank you.
So,
the first that's coming around is the order of conditions for the project. And the second will be
agenda is a continued area resource delineation for 270-0683 parcel 0 Haverhill Street map 57 lot 17.
You always
Gillis.
Like that, but
yeah.
No one can see it on TV land.
You have eagle eyes. It's real.
I think I should like I have copies.
So
All right, thank you. To continue from our previous meeting, another site walk was had last Tuesday. And wetland flag 2C was moved 5 feet up towards wetland flag 3 and to the north, 18 inches. As depicted with the new plan. The buffer has been adjusted as well.
Members of the commission had a couple of site visits. First site visit, we noticed that there was a low spot continuing up towards Batch Elder at almost wetland flag number 2, between 2 and 3.
Correct.
And when we asked the botanist to take some soil samples, we found redoxy morphological features, you know, the presence of a fluctuating a water table during the crowing season, which, you know, as you know, makes it a hydric soil, and there were some high bush blueberries. There was another, I guess,
Dave Crossman, BNC.
Yeah, he came out back out and kind of changed the line between that down there and the third, the old wetland, flag 3, but we also wanted some more. The second time we went back out there, we asked for some more cores, and I think we had it readjusted.
Fine-tuned it down, yeah.
I have a question now. Looking at this, and I was out there. Is that a perennial stream, or is that just a...
That's an intermittent stream.
It's an intermittent stream?
It's like the... headwaters, and it goes from there into North Cedar Swamp.
Okay, so we don't really ask for the bed of the stream depicted on the map?
The center line, no.
The center
no.
Line. Okay, good. It's just, it's like, thinking.
I'm not sure I would even, when did it become a stream? I mean, it might just pool up right at the end.
It's on the southern property limit. There's a dotted arc line. What does that represent?
This right here?
Nope, this right here.
Oh, that must be a...
It's the edge.
That should be there?
Correct.
Okay.
That was a trim of the buffer line that didn't...
All right.
Fully trimmed.
Yeah. Is that shown on the sign plan?
This one? The first one?
You might have just answered my question.
No, it's not shown.
Okay, good.
It isn't shown.
So we do have there was
this
a stamp.
Yeah,
Right,
the plan I have up here today was just a larger scale for visual purposes.
I just want to make sure sometimes we get, you end up getting a copy of the actual stamp version. I just wanted to make sure whatever was filed is actually the
wet stamp, yes.
For this new plan, was the topo redone?
No.
No, it was just translated.
Yeah.
Okay, different line type.
It just looks slightly different. It's still in the same location.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah. Just styled a little bit differently.
That's, again, because of the scale. You're looking at this plan, which is scaled up to 10.
Right.
So that we can see a little better.
Just a question. Is in the contiguous wet zone, if that's the correct term, can you make up for the use of wetlands by creating new wetlands
So there's a lot of things you can do. For an ANRAD, it's a little different. So an ANRAD is abbreviated notice of resource area delineation. So basically, a lot of times people come forward with an ANRAD when you want to know where the line is before you actually put any plan on paper. So there's provisions for if something's, for replacement and replication, and there's criteria both in our bylaws and MassDEP, but that's really separate from what we're looking at here. This is really just, is this where the wetland line is?
Well, when they would come in with maybe, when an applicant comes in with a plan, and they maybe have to cross a stream to get access to an upland area, then we would look at replication. But it's difficult to do, and you have to have, we usually would look at areas on that, the land that they own, and we're usually looking at a 2-to-1 replacement. So area-wise, if they fill, 30 square feet, we'd be looking for some kind of a wetland replication of 60 square feet. That's just a, that's
just an example, right?
Yeah.
And if I may, Rebecca, if I'm correct, the way that I've read it, these replications are only for wetland crossings or work within a traveled area?
That's a limited project under the regulations. And they allow that a little bit more than, and then there have been other cases where, they have filled in wetlands. I mean, more so. I mean, I think as communities get more used to their regulations, they're not as likely to allow that. Mm-hmm. They frown on that.
Well,
but it is allowed. But it is in it, and you would have to get for over 5,000 square feet. You'd have to get a variance through DEP, right?
Yeah.
Which can take a long time.
So it's at the discretion of the Conservation Commission to allow up to 5,000 square feet. A riverfront, there's a 5,000 square foot language, but there's also 5,000 square foot language in the BBW. So if something needed to be replicated, it could be if you could find a spot 2-to-1 and you can guarantee it and you're creating better habitat than exists now. I mean, there's a lot of criteria. And then after all that, the commission can say they just don't want to do it. It's not required. So it's completely up to the commission.
So there's a lot of work to do. There's a lot of requirements associated with it.
The reason I ask is because it doesn't take a Mensa candidate to look at this intrusive finger into where he wants to put the house. And if you calculate the square footage inside that polygram, that you could conceivably turn that into a different orientation /shape and make it larger and or, but I didn't know if that was an appropriate kind of change for this kind of land.
Let me put this into context, and you are on the site.
But before you do that, say, no, not on an ANRAD.
Yeah.
If they need this, we don't design projects. So all that information should come from the applicant.
Okay.
And if they need it, they'll ask, and if they don't need it, because it's gonna be more expensive, I mean, to do that.
And that would be up to this gentleman to know that
he can't fit the house, needs to change things, he would request something like that. We don't change, we're only establishing the line right now.
Okay.
And then that work becomes, that's the work that they'll do later.
Okay.
The important aspect of the ANRAD is currently there's nothing proposed. It's just where is the line?
Okay.
Where's the resource area?
I mean, I could go on a little bit, but I'm not going to. I mean,
no, that's okay, because you'd probably lose me.
Yeah. No,
that's okay.
I just have it's kind of more an administrative question, but so the application says that this ANRAD is for parcel 57-17. Haverhill Street, and so does our agenda. It says map 57, lot 17.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking at the plan, and it says lot 7.
Lot 7
is the subdivision.
And it doesn't say, well, and I'll say in the title of the map, there's no reference to 50 parcels, is there?
Yeah, map 57, parcel 17.
Okay.
Dump.
Gotcha. Okay.
Correct. Yeah, it's on this one too.
I'm just trying to.
Lot 7 is the subdivision lot number.
Okay, all right, then, fine.
Oh, I gotcha. Got it, of Batchelder Road. Of the Batchelder Road subdivision?
It was a three lot, it was a two lot subdivision, that was bordering on a proposed road, Batchelder Road, I believe. Yes, to answer.
Okay, I just wanted to see some continuity from the plan to the document, so, but it's there.
I don't have anything else, I mean, we've seen it.
Yeah, you were, oh, you went separately.
I saw it before, I didn't see what you guys moved, but I know exactly what Chuck was referring to, so, I don't really have an issue, I mean, that's why I wanted to make sure everybody got back out there to see it, so, I don't have any other issues.
My place was loaded with ticks.
I can imagine it's gonna be bad right now.
I got one embedded.
You know, I found one in my head. And I put it in a plastic bag about 2 weeks ago and the damn thing's still alive.
Is it a deer tick or is it a dog tick?
It's a dog tick, but it looks like a wood tick, more than just a generic dog tick.
Yeah.
But I don't get it, I didn't think I got it from there.
No, I definitely got it mine there. So do I have any more questions from members of the commission? Any questions from the community? Can you introduce yourself?
Barbara Melanson, 704 Davis.
Thank you.
There's water that bubbles up in my backyard. There's a spring in the bathroom, and it flows into that stream, which eventually is up to the culvert. It only happens during high water levels, but it does percolate in my backyard. So that stream's been there since I've been there. 73.
Just out of curious, where are you relative to?
I am south of this lot on Haverhill Street.
Okay.
Are you the house next to it?
Yes.
It would be the other side of the
well. Yeah.
It's on the plan, Melanson, right?
I'm sorry?
You're on the plan, Melanson.
Well, not the new one. I'm on the last prep we had.
Right, yeah, I guess the old one.
Yes.
I'm Phyllis Maxwell, and I'm at 93 Batchelder.
Are you next door to them?
Yes, and I agree with Barbara that I have water that comes up in my backyard, too. I don't know where it comes from.
You're the one, you folks have the well back there, too.
Is that what it is, a well?
Yeah, and there's a stone on top of it, and it's kind of loose. It's kind of dangerous back there. Remember?
Stuff they broke down in there. It's kind of deep.
Right.
Yeah,
because there's a ditch right at the end of your property to the northwest.
Isn't it on?
Yeah, it's on the plan.
It's on the
show right here on the map.
Yeah.
Was that put in at some point, or is that just natural?
No, it was installed. It's lined with a concrete block.
How long have you been at that home?
I've been there 48 or 9 years.
Wow. And you were unaware of the well?
It's only recently come, so I could actually see. You know, before the water just came out and I assumed it was draining off of that property.
You're right here, right? Mm-hmm.
Well, when it's draining off of what property? This property here?
Yes.
Is it from Haverhill going up gradually? It's a gradual uphill slope back into Batchelder, correct?
Yes.
So it wouldn't go uphill?
No.
questions.
Is this the appropriate time to address the vegetation, or does that come later?
Yes, you could address the vegetation, because that's what we look at when we determine whether an area is an upland or a wetland community.
There's a lot of wetland plants out there that I haven't seen tagged. They have been in the past when other developers wanted to build in there, and those are not tagged now. But I'm concerned about the water levels, because the water does come up through my basement floor when the water table rises, and removing the vegetation is going to make it worse. And I'm concerned about a foundation going in there, because that's going to take up space that water could settle.
They put the flags on the edge of the wetland on certain shrubs or trees. And yes, when you go towards your property, there are a lot of, you know, low-growing skunk cabbage and things like that. But when you establish a wetland line, you don't put flags on every shrub. So most everything, I think, with the line that they've got represented now, that everything to the south of that line, to their edge of the property, they are assuming is a wetland community. Is that not correct?
Correct.
Yeah. And nothing to the north of it? To the northwest of it?
Yeah, and nothing to the north.
Nothing
so towards
to the
Batchelder.
North, nothing towards Batchelder, where Batchelder takes that curve.
From the delineation, the proposed delineation line.
That's
for Batchelder. There's no wetland plants in there.
That's what this process is determining, where the line is between dry and wet.
For the soil or the vegetation?
Both.
Both.
Both. There are three criteria. Presence of vegetation that you find 50% or more in a wetland community. Hydric soils, which within a certain distance to the top of the soil, where water table, it fluctuates during the growing season. There are things that you see that indicates, you know, ferric oxide, that you know that it's been fluctuating.
The water's been there in the past.
Right.
Even if it's not there
and
right now.
And when you dig a hole, you know, if you see some groundwater. And I don't, we were just using an auger on this. They were using an auger. Yeah.
Yeah, they didn't do it as pit.
No, okay.
There were two shoveled test pits, test pit A2 and test pit A1.
Right. We weren't present for those when those were done.
Chuck, do you have anything for this one yet?
I don't.
Do you have anything else?
Oh, have I something prepared? No. I was going to say, I was out there for two or three times myself, and even one time prior to this applicant coming to the town and submitting his application with another applicant. And I can tell you that the flags and the line seems very similar from two independent people. Now, they don't even know each one of them did this. I saw one flag from the other person on a tree, but outside of that, I didn't see any other ones.
Yeah.
But it's very similar. And I guess that's all I have to offer. I mean, I felt that, you know, we changed it where it needed to be changed, and I was satisfied with the result. And as far as your other question goes, I did prepare
So I make a motion to close the hearing for 270-0683, Haverhill Street, Parcel 0.
Second.
All those in favor? Do we approve the line? Or
you can issue it.
So I make a you to approve the line as shown on the current drawing, I guess I just want to make sure one thing, that the drawing in the file is both stamped and I think just has this.
It's the, this is what you sent me, this exact.
I did send you the 20 scale, which should be signed, which is the one up on the board. This is a 10 scale that I printed today to hand out just for visual purposes, but it's the same plan.
If we want to just note that, you know, if it shows that line, if we want to just note that there's a line on the left side.
So we need at least one full size stamped and sent to the office.
Okay.
So the February 27th last?
No, it says May. It says updated May.
Revised May 3rd.
2017.
So Mike made a motion to issue the May 3rd.
Motion to issue as we did on May 3rd, provided the.
Second.
All those in favor?
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I also want to thank you for this commission that we're able to get out that early last week for that second site visit. I know that was short notice, so thank you. I didn't make it.
We have our liaison to the Board of Selectmen sitting in the back, Mr. Halsey.
Hello.
John Halsey. Welcome. Very happy that you're our liaison.
I just wanted to stop in and say hello. Sorry I'm a little late getting down here.
Felt like liaising, did you?
I was actually liaising somewhere else earlier tonight, so. I'm going to be with you tomorrow morning.
Yeah, I could say you're going to liaison with me tomorrow.
I'm going to be liaison with the food pantry tomorrow. Yeah. There we go.
These two guys are great. They help us all.
Video.
So, John, do you have any questions of us?
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Do you have
just
any
doing my thing, busy.
Yeah, I know.
Liaising.
Good.
Took care of all the other items? No bills, no permits, no.
We're pretty much all set. Would that be?
Actually went a bit longer, but we got a bit done tonight, which is good. We got a pretty big project.
Get done early.
Yeah.
It's a pretty easy one.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah. Friends and Family Day.
Is a save the date for us?
Yeah, that's in there because we have a table for Friends and Family Day. We usually have representation throughout the day,
right.
And so the commission would pick times where they could make it there. And I know Becky in the past has requested that Will's turtle show up.
No.
so it can sit in the sun all day. But yeah, we actually Anika does a raffle. She's usually good for a raffle. And we sit there and ask questions. So it's an informational booth.
You like how you do it 1 year, and now it's you're usually good for it.
Two. She did it twice.
No, we've done this more than once. One year we did native plants. I went to Mahoney's and bought a couple of native plants. I actually asked Mahoney's, and they volunteered. They actually Garden in the Woods last year. They donated a really nice shrub.
Yep.
Somebody wanted it.
Sweet pepper bush.
Yeah.
We also gave away
some time at Materia Cabin.
To Materia Cabin, right?
Mm-hmm.
The same person.
Free advertising.
Very lucky person.
Yeah.
That
the gift that keeps on giving.
Free advertising
yeah.
To Materia
Cabin.
I'm
just a little concerned at the Cheshire Cat smile that he has on his face, and when he keeps on saying, we.
Yeah, there's no me in the we.
Yeah.
There.
Yeah. No, you were there one year. I do remember.
Very good. No, I've gone in the past. The last couple of times I wasn't able to make it, but if I can go, I usually like, you know, I like talking to people. That's, I like doing that, being kind of shooting from the hip, saying hi to everyone. I like all that stuff. So if I go, I usually stay.
Also give the opportunity to discuss.
But I couldn't make it the last
session too.
The last time.
Formal, you know.
I even brought my kids one time, so they helped out.
Was it last year we had the thunderstorm?
Yes.
Yep.
Actually, it's a pretty nice day.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, it's a great event.
Well, that would be the third booth I was in this year, so I'm gonna have to pass. I'm gonna be in the Rotary booth plus in the new Rotary, I mean Reading softball Little League booth we can have, so.
That's all right. We have, well, you know.
I'm not going in the dunk tank.
We'll have, Al's not here and neither is Harry, so we'll volunteer them as usual.
I do wanna make sort of an announcement. We did have a site visit at 44 Roman Lane, and we are gonna discuss that at the end of next Concom meeting as an executive session.
Right.
And it's still under appeal, so.
That would be.
That was yesterday, right at 9?
Yeah.
Yes.
With my son, the orthopedist, he broke his thumb playing basketball Sunday.
It's always something.
That would be the 24th?
Yep.
And would it be at the end of the meeting?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Are we all done?
John, do you have anything for us?
No, I just wanted to, I'm actually, as you know, I visit here even when I wasn't the liaison. I actually kind of enjoy the work that you guys do, and so the opportunity presented itself, and here I am. I just wanted you to know that obviously I'm not gonna be able to get to every one of your meetings, but
We expect you to watch on TV if you're not here then.
That's what I watch endlessly. On CTV.
We like dickering and bargaining, so you'll just have to buy.
Well, there's that. You know, I bring refreshments when I go. There are things I can do. But, you know, I'll get down probably, I'm hoping at least, if not monthly, you know, every 6 weeks or so.
Mm-hmm.
And I would encourage, you know, you as a group and individually, if there's a reason you think that I should be here, in any particular night, then you just let me know that, and I will make every effort to do that. But otherwise, I'll be dropping in, and I actually will be watching.
I think that's a great idea. I think there are oftentimes some where we can see that this is something that, you know, the community is really invested in and are into. So I think those are really the best times for us to make sure we reach out to you and say, hey, this is a great one to come to.
I want to know that, really. If you guys think that if you as a group you want to be sure I'm here, or individually you think I should be, then let me know, and I will make every effort to do that.
Right.
During the year that I was chair, we only had collaborative meetings with about 8 or 9 of the committees, and unfortunately this wasn't one. I wish it had been, really. There are certain committees that are really important to, well, all the committees are important, others have a bigger impact on town, and you guys are one of those committees that does have a big impact. And so we had about 8 or 9 of the committees where we met jointly with the Board of Selectmen. And, you know, if it turns out to be a value proposition for you guys to do that sometime, I'll make sure I arrange that. There are 40 of these of committees, you know, volunteer committees. Try to make all of those turn into, you know, there's not 40 selectmen's meetings anymore, so, you know, obviously you're not going to be able to do that. There's a lot of, everybody's got their own business to take care of as well. But sometimes the business of one matches up with the business of the other, and so that, you know, when that happens, it's always a good time to, you know, to get together collaboratively. I found that by doing that, there's kind of a better working understanding of what everybody else is doing. I think at some point we're going to try to assemble at least chairs and vice chairs of all the committees for maybe a semi-annual workshop, so that everybody knows what everybody's doing. Makes the work easier, I think. So, I'm here, I'm available, I'll be in and out.
Okay.
And if you need me for anything, don't ever hesitate. I know you all know how to get ahold of me directly, so don't hesitate to do that. Thanks.
Thanks, Sean.
Thank you.
Yeah.